Privilege. Perhaps today is the last time that you will see this stuff, but to give it some, to make it a little different, I try to use some color, some red and some blue and so on, to make it look a little more interesting. But in any case, let me summarize. This is the class of hyperbolic systems, and what makes them hyperbolic is this condition here. This n by n matrix for every nu and every u has real distinct eigenvalues, real not necessarily distinct eigenvalues, and n linearly independent eigenvectors, right? And important, with any such system, I assume that there is associated an entropy-entropy flux pair. This is what characterizes an entropy-entropy flux pair, and I will be looking for solutions of this in general in L infinity, so in general they are weak solutions, but I will be assuming that in addition to the system, they satisfy this inequality in the sense of distributions, and that's what makes, to my mind, the solutions admissible from that point of view. As I said last time, this is not the only way of trying to characterize admissible solutions. This characterization here is not sufficient to give us uniqueness, but pleasant thing, we have the following statement: if the function is convex, then at least classical solutions, for as long as they exist, are unique and stable in the L2 sense within the class of admissible L infinity weak solutions. So if you believe this characterization, at least it tells us that classical solutions are admissible, okay? I also sketched the proof last time of local existence theorem for classical solutions, namely, if the initial data are sufficiently smooth, so the gradient, the spatial gradient, belongs to Sobolev space of order L, where L is bigger than half the dimension of our space, then you have a solution in the same function class. You have a solution defined on some interval 0 to infinity such that the gradient at every time t belongs to this space here. And if you look at time derivatives of the gradient, they also belong to a Sobolev space, that each time you're going up in time, you're going down one in space. So that's why you have this relation there, okay? So this is what we proved last time. Then I asked the question whether it's possible to have classical solutions that are defined for all t. In this case, we found that classical solutions are not defined for all t. You have a maximal interval here of existence, and this maximal interval is characterized by the following condition: that the integral from 0 to infinity of the L infinity norm with respect to space here is, this is infinite. So either T infinity is infinity, which is a good sign but very rarely achieved, or if T infinity is finite, then the gradient should blow up, and should blow up badly enough to make this integral here infinite, okay? So that's what we had last time. And then the question was whether it's possible to have solutions, smooth solutions that are defined for all t. And first we try to do this by adding here a fourth term in that form with p of 0, 0. And we found out that, yes, indeed, this yields classical solutions globally defined in time, providing that the initial data are sufficiently small. In other words, again, it's in this class, but now the norm here has to be sufficiently small. And the conditions on this p that would give us this result are two: this one and that one. This condition here tells us that the forcing term here is compatible with the entropy that we have. In other words, the entropy production induced by this term here is greater or equal than zero, so the resulting solution still satisfies this inequality. So in the applications, this means that the second law of thermodynamics still holds for this system here. And the second condition is this one here. It's the Kawashima type condition, as I said last time. And what it does is that it tells us that even though this is only positive semi-definite, somehow there is synergy in the system, so the damping is spread all over the system here. It's not isolated, for instance, in some equations, because you can think that, for instance, you can think of two different systems, one without P, the other with P. You put them together as one system. This condition will still hold. And of course, in that case, you don't expect globally defined classical solutions. This condition is a coupling condition that tells you that there is some collaboration between the equations. So even though the entropy production here is positive semi-definite, still we have globally defined classical solution. Okay? Here, another mechanism that gives us globally defined smooth solutions that I used in order to motivate a different admissibility condition for solutions is to add here a term, second order term, a diffusion term, if you wish, right, that presumably, first of all, will give us classical solutions, and second, will approximate our hyperbolic problem if I put a small parameter here and let the parameter here go to zero, right? And for this system to have globally defined smooth solutions, again, we need two conditions. A condition like that, this is not exactly accurate. Last time I gave you the exact form of the solution of the condition. You have here not zero, but something, a non-zero quantity that a greater equal than zero quantity that I said last time. But morally speaking, we need this condition that tells us again that this system is consistent with the entropy inequality. So this condition is the analog of that condition here. And then again, we use this condition, a Kawashima-Kite condition, that plays the same role as this condition here, tells us that there is coupling between the equations of the system. So even though this thing is only positive semi-definite, it gets all equations get some damping from the system, right? So this is roughly what is going on. Okay. Now, you remember at the first lecture I mentioned that there are two different sort of notions of the theory of hyperbolic conservation laws. Right? One in which you are talking about hyperbolic systems. So, in that sense, this belongs to the theory of hyperbolic conservation laws, and this belongs to the theory of hyperbolic conservation laws. This system is indeed hyperbolic, and so on. But I told you there is a broader definition of or characterization of the this area of hyperbolic conservation laws. And this is the area that is borrowing its techniques and its ideas from the theory of hyperbolic problems. So, for instance, the study of equations of this type, when this is only positive semi-definite, belongs to the theory of, or to the area of hyperbolic conservation laws, even though the system here, of course, is not hyperbolic, right? If this were positive definite here, then the system would have been parabolic and belongs to a different category, right? We give it to somebody else. They use different techniques to deal it. But in the case we are dealing here, where is something between parabolic and hyperbolic, then it belongs to the general area of hyperbolic conservation laws, right? And there are many systems with a similar, in a sense, behavior that belong to that field. And I want to give you a few more examples in order to see how broad and how varied is this class of systems that are not exactly hyperbolic, but they are treated by the same ideas as hyperbolic systems of conservation laws. So, first example I want to present here the so-called Euler-Poisson system. So what is the Euler-Poisson system? Suppose that I consider the Euler equations that, as you remember, govern the let's say, isentropic flow of a gas, of an elastic fluid, and they have this form here. This is the balance of mass. This is the balance of momentum. Okay. Now suppose that you have a force acting on the fluid, then instead of having zero here, you have to put in the force that is acting on the fluid and generates the momentum. Okay. And now so suppose that this is, let's say, a fluid star. Right. So the force is generated by the gravitational field that in turn is generated by the fluid itself, right? So in that case, you have the gravitational potential, let's call it psi, and here is no longer zero, but it's some constant times the density rho times the gradient of the gravitational potential. And the gravitational potential, on the other hand, satisfies the Poisson equation. So this is the Euler-Poisson system, right? So you see it's a coupling of a hyperbolic system with an elliptic equation here, right? So it's not a hyperbolic problem, but it's treated exactly by the methodology of hyperbolic conservation laws. And it turns out that, again, the presence of this coupling here induces a subtle dissipation in the system. And for this system, you can show a theorem in the same spirit as these theorems that I have over here. Namely, if you start with initial data that are sufficiently smooth and small, then you have a globally defined smooth solution. Now, very similar system governs, let's say, the flow of plasma. If you have plasma, of course, in the case of plasma, you have electric charges, you have an electrostatic potential that generates the force here. In that case, you have both positively and negatively charged particles. So you have electrons and ions, for instance. And of course, the electrons are negatively charged, and they're very light, so they move around very easily. The ions, on the other hand, are positively charged, and but they are much heavier, and they move very little. Okay, so for that reason, the way you model this situation is the following. You assume that the ions are not moving at all, and they are there, and they just generate a background field. Okay, and then you have the electrons, and the electrons like a fluid that's governed by this equation here. So you have exactly the same equation. Here, psi, of course, is the electrostatic potential. And here, instead of rho, you have rho minus rho bar here, rho bar being the mass of the provided, the contribution provided by the ions, right? So it's exactly the same system here, right? Or, still another example, there is a model for studying semiconductors called the hydrodynamic model of semiconductors. And this is, again, governed by exactly the same system, except that here you have another term. It's something like 1 over mu, this is a relaxation parameter, times rho v, something like that. Okay. So again, a system of the same form. And all these systems obey theorems similar to the theorems I stated here, you start with data that are smooth and small, and then you have a global defined solution, okay? Here are other examples that are very different, and I will just write the one-dimensional version in order to make things more clear. There are multi-dimensional versions as well. So it's the equations, for instance, of thermoelasticity. In one dimension and in Lagrangian coordinates. And if you want to see exactly what's the meaning of Lagrangian coordinates and so on, the chapter, the second chapter of the book that I did not touch here gives a full exposition for the young students. But the system looks like that. Looks like that. Something like that, let's say. It's not the most general case, but will be enough to explain. So here you have the U that's called strain in mechanics, right, or deformation gradient. Here you have V, the velocity, and theta, the temperature. This equation just expresses the compatibility between strain and velocity, so it's a geometric condition. This equation here expresses the balance, the conservation of momentum, so sigma is the stress that depends on U and theta. And finally, this equation expresses the balance of energy. So this part here is the total energy, is the part of the internal energy and the kinetic energy. Here, the density is reference density, is constant is one. That's why you don't see the density here. So this is the kinetic energy, this is the internal energy. So epsilon is a known function of U and theta. And here, I'm assuming we have Fourier's law, so this is the gradient of the heat flux. Okay. So again, you can look at the system now. You have to make the following assumptions. These functions here, sigma and epsilon, are not completely independent. They are interrelated. So the partial derivative of epsilon with respect to U has to be equal to sigma minus theta times the partial derivative of theta with respect to sigma with respect to theta. This comes from the second law of thermodynamics. Sometimes these are called Gibbs-type relations. And then you have to make the assumption that the stress is an increasing function of the strain, and also that the internal energy is an increasing function of temperature. So once you make these assumptions, without this term here, we would have a hyperbolic system, right? Now, by adding this term here, of course, it becomes a system in the same form as this one. It's a special case of that system. But the assumptions here are weaker, the natural assumptions, than what you are assuming here. So again, for that system, when the initial data are smooth and small, you get a globally defined smooth solution. On the other hand, solutions with large initial data, smooth but large, blow up again in finite time, just like in the hyperbolic case. So this belongs again to the hyperbolic conservation law theory somehow. It's part of the same thing. Here is another example, the last one This is the case in which the source term is non-local. So again, I'm writing for simplicity the one-dimensional version. So again, this is the isentropic motion of a certain material. The first equation, you see, it's exactly the same equation here. U again is the strain, v is the velocity. This gives us the compatibility, geometric compatibility between U and V. The second equation is the equation of momentum. And now you see we have the presence of this term. So the stress, what is the stress here? Here is P plus, oh, I'm sorry, so you can put here plus derivative with respect to x, of course, of this thing. So this is now the stress. Perhaps let me write it in this form. Perhaps it will be more clear. So this is now the stress. You see, the stress depends on the entire history of the strain, not only at the present value of the strain, but the entire history of the strain. K is some relaxation kernel. It looks like this. Okay. That's how K looks like. In the case of a polymer, glass, and so on, these are very standard models, very standard in the theory of polymers, in rheology, and so on. Again, it turns out that this term here provides some dissipation. So again, in this case, if you start with initial data that are smooth and small, you get a globally defined smooth solution. But if the initial data are large, then solutions again blow up in a finite time. And in order to, people say, well, but this term, you know, comes from the past. How can this term influence what happens in the future? Again, as a very simple exercise for the younger students here, consider the case where k of t is, let's say, e to the minus t. Okay? Typical choice in the applications. And assume, let's say, that the function q is identical to the function p. And as a simple 5-minute analysis exercise, show that this system is equivalent to that one. And you see, this system is exactly a system in this form here and satisfies all the properties that we have, right? And therefore, it explains why for this system here we have the same behavior as one gets for that system here. So this is the, so here are some examples. Another mechanism, a different one, I think I mentioned it in my first lecture, that may preserve the smoothness of solutions is dispersion. And I will comment on that later this afternoon, so if I don't, ask me for it. But as you will see, this does not belong to our field, the field of hyperbolic conservation laws. It belongs to the field of linear hyperbolic differential equations, if you wish. So it's a different community that deals with that problem, and I'll explain, I'll comment on that, right? When I'll have some equations on the board so I can talk about it. Okay. So the conclusion is the following. the moral of the story, if we have an entropy and the entropy is convex, some nice things happen, okay? And exactly for that reason, most mathematicians, whenever they write this accounting, they start with the assumption eta of u is convex, and they're happy, right? Now I want to explain that why eta of u is not always convex, right? And what we can do in that case. So I want to go back to some equations that I already presented in my first lecture, but now I want to look at them more carefully. So I want to write again the equations of elastodynamics. Namely, the equations that govern the motion of the isentropic motion, for simplicity, of an elastic material in n space dimensions, n is 3, okay? Let's say it's in three dimensions for definiteness. Okay, so these equations are as follows. I remind you, the state vector u is now the pair of f, which is called the deformation gradient, and it is an m by m valued matrix, and the velocity v, which is a vector, so this is in Rm. So in three dimensions we have the size of this vector is 12, it's a huge system if you wish, and it satisfies, and the system is the following, and now I will write the system in components form. First of all we have this family of equations. So here I takes values from 1 to m, and alpha takes values from 1 to m. So we have m squared, 9 equations in 3 dimensions, and this describes again the geometric compatibility of f and v. I haven't told you exactly what is f and what is v. Had I told you, then you would have seen that these are necessary conditions that express the compatibility between f and v. And then we need m more equations, 3 more equations, and these are provided by the balance, by the conservation of linear momentum. Again, the reference density is assumed to be 1, so there's this form here. And here I assume I'm applying the summation convention. So you see, whenever I'm repeating indices, so this call for j 1 to m. This S, again, is an m by n valued matrix function. It's called the Piola-Kirchhoff stress. Names are not important as far as you are concerned here. And it has the following property, again, induced by the second law of thermodynamics, that it has to be the gradient of some scalar field. So all the information that we need in order to write the system is to know epsilon of f. Epsilon is called the stored energy function or the strain energy, or if you wish, the internal energy in that case. It's the same epsilon that I had before, physically speaking, in the same thermoelasticity. So somebody gives you this function, and from that function you find S, and then you have here a system of m squared plus m equations in m squared plus m unknowns. That's what you have. And then you ask whether that system is hyperbolic and whether that system is endowed with an entropy-entropy flux pair. And indeed, this system is endowed with an entropy-entropy flux pair, and it's this one. So as before, we have the sum of the kinetic energy and this internal energy or stored energy function. This plays the role of entropy here. And the associated entropy flux is again with the summation convention. And it's a very simple exercise, again, a 3-minute exercise, but I recommend it for the students here to show that indeed, if you have a smooth solution of that system, then that solution satisfies the additional conservation law. Remember that here I have adopted the summation convention. This is equal to zero. So every smooth solution satisfies this additional conservation law. Of course, weak solutions don't. But second law of thermodynamics again tells us that good solutions must satisfy this inequality here. So we have the same structure that we have over there. We have a system, we have an entropy, we have an entropy flux, we have this admissibility condition supplied by physics. So the question is this eta convex? This is the first question, right? And is the system hyperbolic? So first of all, you see what eta is. And of course, this part is very convex, right? So the question is whether this part here is convex, right? Now, I think I mentioned that in passing in my first lecture, that unfortunately, this function can never be convex in more than one spatial dimension. Right? People carelessly say, oh, well, let's take it convex. Why not? Okay? But this can never be convex. Can be convex locally, perhaps, in some range of f, but cannot be globally convex. And there are many reasons why it cannot be globally convex. But one basic reason is the following. This epsilon has to be invariant under rigid rotations of the body. And this condition tells us that this function should satisfy this condition. For every non-singular f and for all any orthogonal matrix. And again, it's an exercise to see that any function that satisfies that hypothesis cannot be convex. Okay? Now, when is this system hyperbolic? Well, it turns out, again, a calculation, perhaps nice calculation for the students, is that for hyperbolicity, the condition is that this function epsilon satisfies the following condition. Don't forget the summation convention that I have adapted here. That for any unit vectors xi and nu, this thing should be positive. So I think I already mentioned this may give you the, if you are not careful, to think that this is the same as saying convexity. But it's not exactly convexity, right? Because convexity would have meant something like this. This is convexity. For any matrices V, that this thing is positive. That's convexity. But you see, this thing means that, but only for V that are tensor product of two vectors, right? Only for such V. And these are exactly the matrices that have rank one, right? That's why this condition here is called rank one convexity, okay? So this is the condition of hyperbolicity. Of course, the question is, first of all, whether this condition is compatible with that statement here, and the answer is yes. So there's no physical reason why this condition cannot be adopted, and as a matter of fact, it is mechanically a good condition, right? The real materials satisfy that condition in the stable range and so on, so let's adopt it. But it's not convexity, right? So the question is, what do we do in that case, right? What do we do in that case? We cannot use these theorems because we don't have convexity. Let me now point out, however, that this system here has some additional property. Namely, suppose that I consider the following quantities. Now, the time derivative, if you take the time derivative of this, because of that, the time derivative of this is zero, right? So if in the your initial data you start with initial data for which this is zero, this will stay zero forever, right? And as a matter of fact, it turns out that the physically meaningful solutions of the system should satisfy these additional conditions, right? So that system is endowed with something, some structure here. And the question is, can this structure help you to compensate for the fact that your entropy is not convex, right? Now, let me give you another example from a completely different part of physics, which we have, again, the same situation. So let me consider the case now of electrodynamics. And I'm not going to elaborate on that, but in the book you can read the details. I will go very, talk very briefly about this here. So suppose that, let me remind you what the equations. The equations are, of course, the Maxwell equations, right? So you have here plus the curl of E is equal to zero. So this is the magnetic induction. This is electric field. And then D is the electric displacement. And you have here the magnetic field is equal to zero, right? So these are Maxwell's equations. Again, E and H are functions of B and D. Of course, the standard Maxwell's equations that hold in free space, you know, they have linear relations of epsilon of E and H of B and D. But of course, if you are dealing with a dielectric, then these are nonlinear functions of B and D, right? And again, you can find out that you have a natural entropy. And again, you can find out that that entropy cannot be convex, except in the linear case, right? It cannot be convex. I should have said that in elastodynamics, I said that it's never convex. It's never convex unless epsilon is quadratic. If epsilon is quadratic, then it can be convex. And it's the same thing in Maxwell's equation. So unless you're dealing with quadratic energy, which means linear relations for B and D, for E and H, then it's never convex. Okay. Now let me point out that we have something very similar to this here, because you see, if I take the time derivative of the divergence of B, the time derivative of the divergence of B is zero, right? So if I start with initial data for which the divergence of B is zero, the divergence of B will stay zero forever, right? And similarly, if I take here the divergence of D, the derivative of the divergence of t, time derivative is zero. So if I start with initial data in which the divergence of d is zero, right, it stays zero. Well, actually, very often in physics book, these equations are attached to these equations as part of the Maxwell's equations, but they are not independent conditions. They follow from the other two, right, if the initial data are satisfied. So we have exactly the same structure. And the question is, okay, if we have a structure like that, and if the entropy is not convex, does this structure help us to have theorems like the ones that we have here for such systems, right? So let me first make a general abstract sort of model for systems of this nature, right? And then we'll discuss this. So first of all, I want to give a name to conditions like this. And I will give the name involutions. Well, of course, there involutions are, you know, in differential geometry, and there involutions in algebra, and there involutions. So this is not necessarily a good name, a successful name, but in any case, it has stuck. So let's use it here. So what is involution now? So I will consider now a general hyperbolic system. And I will assume that there are matrices, let's say M sub alpha, with the property that solutions of that automatically satisfy this condition. Under the assumption that the initial data satisfy that condition, okay? So this, for each alpha, these things are K by N matrices. And K is the number of such conditions that we have. So here K is equal to 2. Here K is equal to, I don't know, 9, okay? M squared, whatever. Okay, now when, what are the conditions on G in order to have this property here? The conditions on G is the following, is that so these are the conditions that tell us, it's a simple exercise again for the students here, that whenever this condition holds at t equals zero, then it holds for all t, okay? Now, I want to, here's what happens in that case. Let me first tell you a little bit what's happened in that case, and then I will state these results in some precision. So I unfortunately have to introduce some notation here. So first of all, I will, for each unit vector nu, I will introduce this matrix here, K by N matrix, which is and then I want to consider the kernel of that matrix for each nu and take all the kernels together, take the union of the kernels, right? You are familiar with the term kernel or null space. I don't know what is your favorite term here. Over all nu or over nu directions in space, the nu, of course, describes a direction in space. So this will give us a cone, C. And let's call the involution cone. For instance, if you make that calculation for this system here, you'll find that the involution cone is exactly the set of all matrices with rank 1. Okay, it's the class of all matrices rank 1 coupled with all vectors, right? Because remember that the U is F and V. So here it's all of Rm, but here you have just the matrices of rank 1. In the case of electrodynamics, unfortunately, and I'll tell you in a minute why, unfortunately, the involution cone is the entire space, right? But for the case of elastodynamics, it's not the whole space, it's just a cone. The cone of, well, where V can be anything in Rm, but F has to be rank 1, okay? And as you will see, it turns out that you can prove all these theorems, or essentially these theorems here. I will state them more carefully, of course, the next session, providing that the entropy that you may have for the system is only convex in the directions of the involution cone. So you don't have to have convexity in every direction in space, but only in the direction of the involution cone. So if you believe that, this means that this condition will be as good as convexity because we have this class of involutions, okay? Unfortunately, for electrodynamics, this will not be enough because the involution cone is the whole space, so convexity means convexity, ordinary convexity that we don't have. So I will have to tell you what happens in that case. As I said, I don't want to go into the details of electrodynamics, but I will make some comments. Okay. All right, before we break, now that I remember, let me say, now that I have the machinery, the equations, and so on, let me tell you a little bit about dispersion, right? So I said dispersion means that because the signals spread in space, you don't have breaking of waves, and therefore we may have again globally defined smooth solutions if you start, let's say, with initial data that are smooth, they are small, have compact support, let's say, and then they spread out and signals never break. Now it turns out that, of course, I think I already mentioned that in Euler equations, we don't have, dispersion does not help, right? That is the theorem of Christodoulou that I mentioned, that the 1,000 theorem with 1,000 page proof that shows that dispersion will not really help you, waves break. So to get dispersion, effective dispersion, what you need is that you need that you have some linear degeneracy of your system. So the system cannot be non-linear in all directions, right? You need some kind of linear degeneracy. And of course, you want this only near the equilibrium point, because all these theorems are basically linear. Even these theorems here are basically linear. If you look at the proof, essentially, you look at the linearized form of the system and you get some estimates, and then you just show that the non-linear thing goes along because things are small and so on, right? So all these are based on having small things and looking at linear things. So these extra conditions are called null conditions. So our friend Kleinerman, for instance, is the person who introduces the null condition. So what is the null condition associated to the equations of elastodynamics? The null condition is this. Always, I'm observing here the summation convention. At zero. So if this condition holds at f equals 0, then you have the null conditions. And what happens is that, well, if you follow the waves, you can see that, well, along the characteristics, the solution remains nice. And in the transverse direction, because of the presence of this condition, things are not bad. So dispersion wins, and solutions don't blow up. Right? The person who worked on the equations of elastodynamics from this point of view is Sideris. Remember the same person who proved that blow up of solutions of the Euler equation, discussed my first lecture. Yeah? But now the techniques that are used there, of course, are techniques, very refined techniques from the linear theory of hyperbolic differential equations for the wave equation. Right? And therefore, this kind of problems do not belong to our community, the community of hyperbolic conservation laws. They belong to somebody else, right? So I don't want to take them away from them. But you should know that this is also a mechanism that provides globally defined smooth solutions. Okay? So you must be tired. Let's take a break, and then we will continue. Eh? I want to, first of all, enlarge the notion of an entropy flux pair. Right? You remember that this condition that guarantees, characterizes what is an entropy flux pair, means exactly the following: that when U is a smooth solution, then this thing is equal to zero. That's what this condition does. Right? So, in the case of a system with involutions, you say, well, perhaps now I will look for entropy flux pairs that form a broader class in the sense that they make this equation satisfied for all u that satisfy the differential equation plus the involution. Okay? So these entropies I call contingent entropies because they are contingent to the involution. They were first introduced by Denis Serre. And eta q are a contingent entropy flux pair if as before, but here you allow to have also another term here. Some function here of u times m alpha, the m matrices that appear here in involution. And very easy to see that, okay, if you have a smooth solution of this equation, and in addition it satisfies the involution, then again, that smooth solution satisfies this thing as an equality. Right? So it's the same philosophy behind it. Okay? Of course, every classical entropy in the previous n is still an entropy flux pair. You just take c equals 0. But you have more now. And you need more, as you will see. And you get more in the case of the examples as I said here. So for instance, in the case of elastodynamics, let me erase this since it's not our field, it's not our territory. So contingent entropies here For instance, the determinant of f turns out to be a contingent entropy. Or if I consider any, if I consider the matrix of the cofactors of f and take any component of that, this is another example of a contingent entropy in that case. You will see why these are important, these are useful in the thing, right? So these are not entropies, but they are contingent entropies, right? And now I would say again, the stereotypical for the young students, they should check that these are entropies and find the entropy flux. But let me tell you, this is no longer an easy exercise. It's either a very hard and nasty calculation, if you really compute what these things are and try to see what happens, or else it requires some thought. But if you look in the book, you can find the answer, right? If you want to be challenged, try to do it by yourself. You will see it's not an easy calculation to check this. You see, taking derivatives of determinant and matrices of cofactors and so on, it's not an easy thing, unless you know some differential geometry and you know exactly how to make these calculations efficiently. Otherwise, you'll be lost in long calculations. Again, in the case of electrodynamics, a contingent entropy are the components of the cross product of B and D. And I saw this for the first time in a paper by Denis Scher, but since the Maxwell equations have been worked to death for a century and a half, I'm sure somewhere somebody must have made an observation before, but I haven't seen it. The first time I have seen that was in a paper by Denis Scher, okay? So there are contingent entropies here, I should put, of course, because this is a vector, I mean every component of this vector is, each component is a contingent entropy, okay? So there are contingent entropies. You will see that they come very handy, but I will not use them yet. So now, here I will I'll state a technical lemma that is more or less the essence of why whenever you have convexity in the direction of the involution cone and you have the involutions, it suffices for proving all the existence theorems, stability theorems, and so on. So this is the lemma. And I will try okay. Let me state it and then I will see. So suppose that I have here some matrix valued function and just in L infinity with the property that it is positive definite in the direction of the involution cone. In other words, I have the following condition that some positive number here. But this is for all x that are in the involution cone. So this matrix is not positive definite. This thing holds only in the direction of the involution cone. And now I want to assume that this function here locally has small oscillation, okay? So I will not write exactly the condition for that, but I'll draw a picture. I will assume that Rm is decomposed as the union of a finite number of domains, let's say. And if you take any one of these domains and you take any two points, let's say x and y in that domain, then the distance of P of x from Py is less than this positive number mu. So it's less than mu minus 2 delta, where delta is some positive number. So the oscillation is relatively small. So I claim that under these conditions, you have the following estimate holds. You have the following estimate, that if you take any function here, v, that's in L2, and satisfies the involution in the sense of distributions, and you integrate it over Rm, this is greater or equal than some positive constant, and in fact the positive constant is exactly this delta here, this number delta, times the L2 norm of V squared, minus a correction, some number A, times the W1 minus 1, 2 norm of V squared. Okay, let me try to explain what's behind it, okay? And this is true for all V in L2 that satisfy the involution. Namely, in the sense of distributions, we have so I repeat what we have. We have a matrix that's not exactly positive definite, and it has small local oscillation in that sense. And in that case, this thing here is bounded from below by that. If P were positive definite, then of course this would have been obvious and A would have been zero, right? So the thing is that even though P is not positive definite, because it satisfies the involution, we have this condition. Now I will relate that with a theorem that is familiar to most of you, and the philosophy is the same. And in fact, that theorem is a special case of that, if you wish, of this structure here. But first, I will assign, because it's a simple exercise to the young people, show that this is indeed true if P is a constant matrix. Assuming that P is a constant matrix, show that this is true, and in fact, A is zero in that case. And this is just Parseval's relation in Fourier analysis, right? In that case, you can compute this using Parseval's relation, and you will see how this condition here comes very handy, tells you that you only have to estimate things in the direction of the involution cone, and therefore, even though you only have this condition for x in the direction of the involution cone, this thing works out. Okay. So this is a simple exercise, right? So now the reason you have this correction here is because P is not really constant, but depends on x, but depends on x weakly, as you can see here, right? So passing from the constant case to this case, what it does is a partition of unity. In other words, you show that if it's true for P constant, then it's true if P changes a little bit, right? And then you use some kind of partition of unity to show that you can pass from local to global, and the price you have to pay is this correction, which of course has the bad sign, but as you can see is in a lower space, is in the space minus 1, W minus 1, 2, right? Now, I want to bring to your attention the famous Gording's inequality in elliptic PDEs, right? It's exactly the same philosophy there. The Gording's inequality, you remember, works for elliptic systems. Of course, for elliptic equations, it's convexity. But for elliptic systems, it's no longer convexity. It's something similar to what I have here, rank one convexity, right? But Gording's inequality still works, and works for exactly the same reason. right? Because you have second derivatives and you take the Fourier transform when you have constant coefficients, and this is just Parseval's relation. And then if you want to extend it to the case and so on, you just take partition of unity and so on. So it's exactly the same philosophy here. And you can read the precise proof if you care in the book. But I think it's much more instructive to consider P constant by yourself and do this calculation and see that the thing works. And then you will understand why having convexity just in the direction of the involution cone is compensated by the fact that you have this condition here. So this is the only thing that you need, the only tool that you need, in order to repeat essentially the type of analysis that I said in the case of a convex entropy and prove exactly the same theorem. So in particular, I will write these theorems here. So first of all, you can prove that if the gradient of the initial data R in HL for L bigger than M over 2, then this implies that there exists a solution whose gradient at this time t belongs to exactly the same space. In fact, is here CK0 t infinity for a maximal interval, and here you have HK. Sorry, L minus K, and K here goes from 0 to L. Right? You have the same theorem. In fact, if you look at the book, you will see that this theorem is stated, a weaker form is stated for this theorem. Here, instead of CK, you will see in the book WK infinity, right? Because when I wrote the book, that's the best result that I knew, right? But actually, it's true, CK there, I have proved this is CK again. So you remember I pointed out last time that passing from W, first you prove WK here instead of CK. And then you have to show that actually it's not only WK, but it is CK, right? And you use convexity for doing that. It's the convexity of the entropy, again, is used. As I told you, this is not a trivial statement. It requires some depth, right? So I thought that it works only in the case of convex entropy. But then I found out that it works very well also in the case of here. So you have CK there. You have the analog of this theorem also, but with some provision. So let me state what you have in that case. So another result that you get by the same argument is the following, that suppose you have, first of all, a smooth solution, a classical solution, so U bar classical solution. And then you have U, an L infinity, admissible weak solution, admissible in the sense that the entropy condition is satisfied. Both of them, we assume, satisfy the involution. And what I would like to prove is exactly what I had in the convex case, namely that the integral over Rm, okay, I had a local result. Let me write the global result. It's the same. The integral over Rm of the L2 distance of these two solutions at time t. Okay, let me write it a little bit more carefully. Some function of t here times the integral over Rm of right? So this is the conclusion that I want. And in the convex case, this is the assumption, this is the conclusion. But here, unfortunately, I can only prove that under the assumption that U has locally small oscillation. Namely, that if I take any point xt, if I take the Lim sup of as x converges, as y converges to x, and as tau converges to t, this thing is sufficiently small. And of course, the reason you have this restriction is because in that lemma, you have this requirement here. You can't prove it for arbitrary matrix value functions p of x and p of y. You see what this means. This means that if I consider singularity, when I have singularity, the singularity, if I have a jump, if I have a shock, for instance, in my solution, the shock has to be relatively weak. If you have continuity, at points of continuity, this is zero. So it is correct. But it's only at points where you have discontinuities that this thing comes into play and tells you that you cannot allow jumps that are arbitrarily large. They have to be small. So modulo this restriction, which I don't know how to remove, we have exactly the same result here. You have stability, and in particular uniqueness of weak solutions, so long as they exist, within the broader class of admissible weak solutions. Okay, so another remark is the following, that in this theorem, what you need is not necessarily a convex entropy, or entropy that's convex in the direction of the involution cone, but even entropy that is even contingent entropy. In other words, if you don't have an entropy, if you have a contingent entropy, it's good enough. Of course, in the case of elastodynamics, we don't have to worry about that because we have a real entropy that satisfies the proper convexity in the direction of the involution cone, namely this entropy that I gave you here. Right. But even I only had a contingent entropy, it would have been enough for stating the theorem that I have here. So for the case of elastodynamics, this thing does the trick. We have what we need, classical solutions for a short time, and solutions, uniqueness of the solution and stability of the solution within the class of good weak solutions. So we can go home. However, when it comes to electrodynamics, then we are in trouble. The reason being that in that case, the involution cone is the entire space. We have an entropy. That entropy is not convex. Then we say, yeah, but perhaps it's convex in the involution cone. But then the involution cone is the whole space. So it's not convex, and this theorem does not apply to the case of electrodynamics. Right? So what can we do in the case of electrodynamics? And as you will see also for the case of elastodynamics. Let me erase this thing. Now, let me make the following remark. I told you that these quantities here are indeed contingent entropies in the case of elastodynamics. But actually, they're a little better than that. In other words, they have the following interesting property, that this condition here, which supposedly satisfied for smooth solution, works also as an equality for weak solutions. In other words, for any L infinity function, any L infinity solution of the equations of elastodynamics, these functions here satisfy this property for appropriate Q in the sense of distributions. This is something it's very much related with these magic properties that determinants have. It is very much related with other applications of these things in compensated compactness and so on. It's exactly the same kind of phenomenon. That these functions, even though they are very nonlinear, they have some linear degeneracy that allows us to treat them as if they were linear functions somehow. Right? So this is something that we should keep in mind. The other question is, okay, if we consider the case of electrodynamics, where this is a contingent entropy, as I said before, the question is this also, does this also have the same property? Namely, that this condition is satisfied as an equality. And the answer is not in general, okay? So this is not satisfied automatically as an equality. With one important exception, a model in nonlinear electrodynamics that was considered very much in recent years by mathematicians is the famous Born-Infeld model. By model, I mean special constitutive relations that relate E and H to B and D. This was proposed in the 1930s by Born and Infeld. I don't think that physicists care very much about this these days, but mathematicians discovered it 10 years ago, and they found out that it has very many interesting properties. And the person who did very good work on that is Jan Brenier. So if you are interested in the theory of the Born-Infeld thing, you have to look at his papers. Okay. Now, in the case of the Born-Infeld model, and as I said, model means that E and H are very special, explicitly given functions of B and D, and in the book I have this function, so you can see exactly which functions they are. This thing satisfies this equality, at least if the function U is a function of bounded variation, is in the space BV of function of bounded variations, right? My conjecture is that they satisfy for L infinity solutions as well, right? But I don't know how to prove it, at least I haven't tried to prove it. But at least in case BV, I will talk about BV, and then you will know more about it. But BV is like a piecewise smooth function in a certain sense. So all the singularities are on surfaces of dimension one. And checking whether, and if you look at any entropy, this quantity here is a measure. You remember I told you that's a measure. Now this measure is supported, is concentrated on the discontinuities. You see, as I told you, in the case of smooth solution, this is exactly zero. Now, if it's piecewise smooth, then it's zero except at the points of where you have singularities, right? So you can check whether this condition is satisfied as an equality in the BV case by just looking locally whether it's satisfied at any discontinuity surface. And then it's a simple calculation to show that indeed it is satisfied as an equality. Right? So I believe it's true for L infinity, but in any case it's true at least for BV functions. Well, anyway, so why do I care about that? Okay. Now, I claim the following. I want to introduce still another notion, the notion of polyconvexity. I will tell you where the name came from in a minute. So I want to have the following structure. I have my system with involutions. I have an entropy, eta, that is not convex. But in addition to that, I have a list of contingent entropies for which this thing is satisfied as an equality. Okay? So this is the case in elastodynamics. This is the case in electrodynamics, at least in BV situation and so on. So suppose that I have this structure here. So let me write what I have. So first of all, I have involutions. I have an entropy-entropy flux pair. And I have a set of contingent entropies for which this thing is felt as an equality. And I take them, all of them, and I list them, and I make a vector-valued function out of them. So W of U, this is the vector of contingent entropies other than eta, right? So in the case of elastodynamics, this vector is at least m squared plus 1 dimensional, right? The m squared come from this. I have m squared contingent entropies here plus 1. I have m squared plus 1. Perhaps there are more that I don't know, but certainly I have this 10 in three dimensions contingent entropies. I put them together, so I have a vector here of dimension 10. In the case of electrodynamics, it is this B cross D. It's three dimensions, right? A three-dimensional vector that I attach. I put them together as a vector, and I put it there. And now I say that the entropy eta, that is not convex, is polyconvex if it has the following property, that eta of u is a convex function of u, but also w of u. Okay? So this is a function of n variables. This is a function of n plus whatever the size of this vector is. Right? So you have greater flexibility to have something which is in that form. Eta itself is not a convex function of u, but it has this form where phi is a convex function of this longer list. So for instance, in elasticity, this would mean the following, that epsilon of f, which is not a convex function of f, is nevertheless a convex function of the following extended list of variables, f, f star, and determinant of f. Right? For instance, suppose that epsilon of f is determinant of f. This is not a convex function of f, right? But it is in that form where phi is a convex function, right? So you can see this is a much richer class than the class of convex functions. It is not only richer, but it's exactly the correct class mechanically. In other words, people who were looking at elastostatics, elastic problems in equilibrium, had discovered this relation here. I will tell you in a minute why. And they had called it polyconvexity, right? And I don't know who gave the name. I first found it in papers by John Ball, but perhaps it had been given before by Morey. I'm not sure. I don't remember now who introduced exactly the term. Why is this relevant in elastostatics because it's very intimately related to the calculus of variations. In other words, in elastostatics, you try to solve the equations of elasticity by minimizing this functional here. It's this functional that you try to minimize. That's what elastostatics is. Minimize this. So you see, you have there exactly the same problem that you have, we have here. If you could assume that this is a convex function of f, then it's a standard problem in the calculus of variations. Minimize a convex function, integral of a convex function, right? But unfortunately, as I told you, this is never convex. So Ball made the observation that when epsilon is polyconvex, in other words, it has this structure here, then you can minimize the functional. And the reason is the following. These same functions, determinant f, f star, are weakly continuous in LP. Right. So again, you remember that when we are dealing, the first thing we learn in function analysis is that you have a nonlinear function. It's not weakly continuous in LP, right? Well, there are some exceptions. And the exceptions are, in that case, the determinant and f star. And the reason is, again, the involutions and so on. It's not, it's related to. So it's the same thing. It's not something different. It appears under completely different mathematics, different area, and so on. But the root cause, in all cases, is the same, right? So, and as I said before, if you look at any book in mechanics, in particular, the theory of rubber, because a nonlinear elastic material that conveniently described by internal energy of that type is rubber, right, for which you have large deformations, you find out that indeed the constitutive relations that engineers have measured, have developed, are in this form here, right? So this is not just a creation of a mathematician, it's a real thing, it's the creation of nature, okay? So now it turns out that when you have polyconvexity, then you can prove again everything that you have already proved for the case of convex entropy. In other words, polyconvexity together with involutions give you exactly existence of solutions, classical solutions, for a short time when the initial data are sufficiently smooth and small. They give you uniqueness and stability of classical solutions within the broader class of weak solutions that satisfy the involutions and the entropy inequality, right? So you can do elastodynamics. Of course, you can do elastodynamics even without that, as we have seen, because of the just involutions. But in electrodynamics, for these Born-Infeld constitutive relations, you need this in order to be able to prove existence and so on and so on. Okay, so this is it. Now, I'm somewhat exhausted, so I will not even try to, I'm sure you're exhausted too, so I will not try to say anything more. Let me just finish with the following. Now, as I said, you have seen this thing here, and you will not see it again in this course. And the reason you will not see this again in this course is that, unfortunately, we can do nothing with it beyond what I have told you, right? In other words, we know very little. There's no existence of weak solutions, and therefore, it's for the young generation. I hope that you will see it in your dream somehow, and then one morning you will wake up and you will have some idea on how to deal with this problem, right? There are also good, perhaps I should not be saying such cynical things to younger people, good reasons to believe that perhaps it's not a well-posed problem somehow. In other words, there's no hope at that level of generality to develop a good theory, that things will blow up, that in general, most cases, and so on. But you should not take these things seriously, these pessimistic predictions. This is for old people. The young people always say, no, we can do it, and I will do it. Perhaps not tomorrow, it will take some time, perhaps many years. But this is the right attitude for young people. However, let me point out that there is one case for which you can do everything. This is the case for which nothing works, okay? But there is a case in which everything works. And the thing that everything works is the case where n equals 1. So this is the case of a scalar equation. We have just one equation, of course, a nonlinear equation in several space dimensions. And as I said, for more than one dimension, nothing works. No matter what people have tried, it has failed. For this case here, everything works. No matter what people have tried to use, it has succeeded, right? Of course, it succeeded in a very beautiful way. In other words, it's a very beautiful and interesting theory. And if you look in your book, chapter 6 of the book is dedicated to the theory of that, and you will see that there are many different methods for constructing solutions. You can add viscosity, pass to the limit, it works, it gives you the solution. You can write a finite difference scheme to approximate solutions, you pass to the limit, it works, it gives you the solution. You use kinetic theory somehow, you use some kind of pseudo-Boltzmann to pass to the limit, it works again, right? You use a relaxation method, it works. You use the function analytic theory of contraction semigroups in Banach space, it works, okay? So in the case n equals 1, everything works. In the case n bigger than 1, nothing works. So this is why you will not see this equation again. So now look at it for the last time, because what I will do next time is that I will keep n bigger than 1, but I will take now m equals 1. I will consider the case of one space dimension. One space dimension systems, but one space dimension. Right. Here a lot can be done, a lot has been done. Not that it's a complete theory, as you will see. It's a very restricted theory, but at least I can talk about it for months, if you wish, or years, right? Because people have done a lot. Now, I understand that at least for some of you, this is completely new. In other words, you have never seen that. So my next lecture will be very basic. And in a certain sense, you know, I feel a little bit sort of uncomfortable, because this is material that's very standard and very old and very sort of well known to many, many people. But for sort of completion, since I asked, I found out that some of you have not seen these things before, I will give a preview and or a review. Right, so next time, those of you who know the basic theory of one-dimensional systems of conservation laws, hyperbolic conservation laws, don't bother to come. I will talk about things that are very standard. Shocks and rarefaction waves and the Riemann problem and self-similar solutions and this and that, you know, this standard stuff. So this will give us the tools that we need in order to start doing certain things that are still not well developed, not completely understood, etc., etc. Okay, so this is more or less the program for the remainder of the course. But at least you will not see that equation again at that level of generality. All right, thanks. So we will continue now on Thursday. And on Thursday, there will be, as I said, no break, so we can finish by 5, so you can attend the lecture of dynamical systems next door, okay?